You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, I'm Professor Gus Martin, and welcome to Criminal Justice Administration 443, Criminal Law and Justice Administration. Today, we are going to look at another categorization of criminal activity. These are the offenses against public order and the administration of justice. When we talk about public order, administration of justice, understand that we're referring to violations of the seamless or smooth operations of governmental functions. This is what we're talking about. It refers to interfering with the seamless application of government functions. So let's begin with crimes against public order. As you'll see, this refers to order within society, but also order within the operations of government. Clearly, there are a lot of these public order offenses, many of them involving simply our behavior on the street, but others involve looking at what government operations do. So, public order offenses are those that disturb or invade society's peace and tranquility. They are mostly malum prohibitum. As you can see, they are mostly malum prohibitum. And they are illegal because we say so, because we don't like them. So let us begin by looking at breach of the peace. It is defined exactly as how it looks. In other words, the peace of society has been breached by my behavior, someone else's behavior. One of the greatest freedoms we have is to be left alone. Breach of the peace interferes with that. So that is what we are referring to. Now, easily understood though, it is an act that disturbs the public tranquility or order. It's a catch-all crime at common law. It includes acts that were not otherwise criminal, includes acts that could cause disorder. In modern statutory law, certain kinds of language or offensive behavior is prohibited. So, for example, noise complaints. The breach of the peace is a catch-all, and very often you will not see this particular language in the crimes code, but conceptually, it is there, even if you don't see it listed as being breach of the peace. The same with disorderly conduct. Disorderly conduct also refers to essentially the same thing as breach of the peace. It's a purely statutory creation and did not exist at common law. Disorderly conduct refers to specific, purposeful, and unlawful behavior that tends to cause public inconvenience, annoyance, or alarm. And so statutes can list various crimes, and these crimes are often separately listed, but sometimes they're just batched within disorderly conduct. It could be fighting, vagrancy, public intoxication, etc. And even just noise complaints. Having a raucous party in someone's backyard that disturbs the neighbors, that could be disorderly conduct. Now, fighting happens. It can happen on the street. It could happen within a bar, or it could happen within any sort of institution. It could be in a mall. Someone looks at someone the wrong way, and they begin fighting. Well, fighting is illegal. And there is something known as affray, which is very similar to fighting, but it is a legal term. So let's explore this. First of all, this discovers there's fighting and affray governs three types of behavior. Unlawful fighting in public places, something known as affray, and the use of fighting words. Now, firstly, affray is defined as the fighting of persons in a public place to the terror of the people. So it's public fighting, and people are fearful of this public fighting. The term affray derives from the term from the word afraid. So it is an altercation that tends to alarm the community. So this sort of fighting could be very severe fighting, violent fighting. Technically, it is an affray, though. And now, fighting words. This is defined as utterances that are an affront to the public peace and that are intended to provoke those at whom they are directed. Words that might incite the recipient of those words to become violent. So understand, these are fighting words. You've all heard the term, them's fighting words. And people think nothing of it. They're just fighting words. It's only language. Well, fighting words can lead to an arrest. So words that communicate ideas are generally protected under the First Amendment. Simply ideas, political ideas, whatever it might be, are protected, even if they are offensive. Fighting words are not protected under free speech constitutional guarantees because the words can be dangerous. So understand one thing about freedom of speech and words. Language can cause people to react violently. That's why language and words can be regulated. And challenging someone to a fight, insulting them racially or by religion or gender, whatever it might be, those could be considered to be fighting words that would lead to an altercation, and they can be regulated. One behavior in the world, not just the United States, not just within the Anglo-American criminal legal system, one behavior that is very common and universal is the abuse of alcohol and drugs. Here we're talking about alcohol and drug use that is criminal. And public intoxication. What happens if someone is very drunk or very high on drugs and they're in the public? That is what this is referring to. Once again, we are still within classifications that could be known as disorderly conduct or breach of the peace. But specifically, drug crimes are broken out in state law and federal law. To begin, laws that refer to substance abuse in public places, that's what we're beginning with. Some laws prohibit private drunkenness in dry counties or communities. That's rare in the modern era, but there still are some dry counties or communities. But what we're looking at is public order and morality when it comes to the use of alcohol and drugs and intoxication. Public order refers to a concern that intoxicated people will cause trouble. And then there's morality, in which there's a stigma of public intoxication. The modern trend is to treat intoxication as a disease, of course, something that should be treated by professionals. But that's very recent. Until very recently, public intoxication or alcoholism, drug addiction was a moral issue. And it was considered to be a stigma rather than a disease. This is very representative. So driving under the influence, or DUI, refers to any movement by any vehicle with high blood or alcohol content, or any alcohol consumption and impaired driving ability. That would be driving under the influence, or DUI. Now, one thing to keep in mind about this is that it could be any movement in any vehicle. That's what we have to be aware of. High blood alcohol content. So there are any number of tests that can be done to determine whether someone might be high, might have high alcohol content. If we are suspected of having a high alcohol or drug content, our blood is no longer our private property. It can be withdrawn from us and tested for high alcohol content, as can our urine or, frankly, our saliva and other things. And then there are sobriety tests that can be taken if we are pulled over in our vehicle. And the sobriety tests are actually rather effective. They're fairly efficient. Our next classification is unlawful assembly, rout, and riot. We have heard of unlawful assembly and riot, but there is another category there known as rout. This is a very ancient crime, very ancient concept that refers to public order, and it could involve political uprisings, for example. It could involve any number of things. But what we're looking at here is potentially violent social disorder. So let us look at this. We have to keep in mind that there are any number of different crimes within this classification. Each one of them has a long case history, a long statutory history. First of all, inciting a riot. This is when someone is verbally provoking others to riot. The person at the podium is using intentionally inflammatory language. They're saying, let's go out and let's burn and let's loot. Rout is when the potential rioters prepare themselves. They arm themselves with objects. They could, these days, it could be knives or pipes or baseball bats or firearms. The riot is an overt act committed by the assembly of people. The rioting is the actual violent end point from the incitement and the rout. A disturbance of a public assembly is similar. It's not quite as violent, but this type of disturbance is caused by any place a group is lawfully assembling. These rioters are vandalizing a church and yelling obscenities at the group. So if there's, for example, a church or a peaceful protest, you know, in other words, a First Amendment protest that's peaceful, and people are yelling at them and yelling obscenities, maybe throwing tomatoes or something at them, that is a disturbance of the public assembly. Lastly, most people have heard of the term lynching, but don't know what it is. There's a technical term for what exactly a lynching is. It's when a person is taken from custody of the law. A person is in lawful custody, but a mob, a lynch mob, takes someone from the custody and kills them. They're taken from a jail or taken from a police car, for example, and the person drags them out and kills them. There's a long and ugly history to lynching in the United States, as we know. It used to be racially motivated, but and it was a mob action, not just an individual action. Now, vagrancy and loitering. These are broadly defined. There is no exact definition of vagrancy and loitering. It differs from jurisdiction to jurisdiction, but they are crimes that are on the books. And it's a very old crime that goes back to the beginning of common law. So, vagrancy and loitering. Common law vagrancy was the act of going about from place to place. Without visible means of support, people who were idle or refused to work, or who lived without labor on the charity of others. These days, we would call that homelessness. Someone who is homeless does these sorts of things, but we treat it very differently compared to common law. In statutory law, it's often very broadly written. Sometimes it's overly broad or overly discretionary, and those laws can be struck down. There is a new emphasis on loitering, meaning just hanging out, just being somewhere without any reason and just staying there. And there's a recognition of homelessness. Homelessness is considered to be a societal issue that should be treated, it should be dealt with, rather than simply criminalizing someone who is homeless. So again, these vagrancy and loitering evolve with society. Weapons possession is a controversial issue in the United States. The United States Constitution, the Second Amendment to the Constitution, allows for the people, meaning you and I, to keep and bear arms. To keep them means to bring them into our homes and collect them if we want to, or just have them there for home protection. Keep and bear arms. To bear arms means that we can carry them with us. The United States is arguably an outlier among the Western democracies in this, because in many countries, many Western democracies, weapons possession is highly regulated. It's certainly regulated in the United States. So let us explore this, because our approach, the American approach, is arguably an outlier in comparison to other Western democracies. The Second Amendment establishes the right to keep and bear arms. The right to keep and bear in public or to possess other arms is politically debated, but we can keep and bear arms publicly under certain circumstances. Laws have been enacted that are restricting minors, the mentally ill, and felons from owning or possessing, whether it's legally permissible. Now, there are also venue restrictions, such as schools, being near schools, being near government buildings, private businesses also. So these restrictions are valid. They're constitutional. But a government, meaning a state or a federal government, cannot simply say it is now illegal to buy or to carry arms. It has to be restrictive language, regulatory language, but it cannot simply say we can't do it anymore. Immigration is the foundation for the United States. With the exception of indigenous peoples, everyone came from somewhere else. Everyone's people, everyone's heritage came from somewhere else. Immigration into the United States is cultural. It has always been controversial because the group that has been here for a generation or two questions whether the next group should be permitted to arrive into the United States. So understand this is hotly debated. It has been hotly debated since the beginning of the Republic, and it continues to be. But let us look at what we mean by immigration crimes. It is clear that the federal government, not state governments, has the authority to decide who may be admitted. There are always federal laws that restrict immigration or federal laws that open the gates or close the gates. So it's always been a federal function, and there have always been some controversial decisions by the federal government. The bottom line here is that in order for someone to immigrate into the United States, there are certain rules and regulations that have to be complied with. It is unclear whether the states share authority with the federal government to enforce immigration laws when they are influenced by immigration. So, for example, border states are the front lines, essentially, of illegal immigration. And they argue many times that they should have the right to enforce immigration laws. Well, for the most part, states do not have that authority to enforce immigration laws. Only the federal government does. But there have been some violations of this, and there has been some vigilante activity, which is illegal, to enforce immigration laws. So again, it's a hotly debated and politicized kind of issue. Now, crimes against the administration of government. There are a lot of them. But we are just going to explore a few of them, but understand that these crimes are exactly what they look like. These are crimes against the seamless administration of government, against the smooth operation of government. If we violate that, if we interfere with it, we've just engaged in criminal activity. So let us explore several of them. This is, once again, a class of social order offenses. They consist of many crimes against the administration of government. We are going to look at a number of these, but you understand that these are categorized. These are classifications. Beginning with treason and related offenses, what you need to know about treason is that it's a very serious crime. It is one of the very few non-homicidal crimes that we can be executed for. Treason is a capital offense, and it is the only crime mentioned in the Constitution. The crimes that we've been talking about are based on state criminal crimes codes. So the Constitution in Article 3, Section 3 says that the crime of treason shall consist only in levying war against them or in adhering to their enemies, giving aid and comfort to the enemy. No person shall be convicted of treason unless the testimony of two witnesses in the same overt act or on confession in open court. So the crime is the only one in the Constitution, and it explains how we can be convicted of treason. And remember, we can be executed for committing treason. Perjury and criminal contempt are both similar crimes. Perjury is the willful giving of false testimony under oath in a judicial proceeding. Subornation of perjury occurs when someone procures another to commit perjury. In other words, they ask them to lie on their behalf under oath. False swearing occurs when the false statements are given in non-judicial proceedings. So it's non-judicial. The bottom line here is that perjury is a serious crime, and it's done under oath. Once someone gives oath, they must tell the truth. Criminal contempt is one of two violent actions: willfully disobeying or disregarding a public official, that's criminal contempt; It could be a judge. It could be a police officer. Disrupting, embarrassing, or humiliating a court or other official proceeding. So if I were to go into court and begin yelling at the judge, that would be criminal contempt. Obstruction of justice refers, at common law, referred to interference with the orderly processes of courts. It was a misdemeanor then, but it is still a crime under modern statutes, but it's been extended to legislative and administrative agencies. In other words, if I'm called before Congress and I begin yelling at the members of Congress, that could be obstruction of justice. So there are types of obstruction of justice: influencing or injuring a police officer or a juror, obstructing law enforcement, tampering with a witness, victim, or informant, retaliating against a witness, victim, or informant. Obstruction of justice is a very serious offense if we engage in any of these particular behaviors. Misconduct in office. This is when, if I am an elected official or another kind of official, an appointed official perhaps, it's willful, unlawful behavior by public officials in the course of their official duties. Three kinds of misconduct. I refer to these as the feasances: nonfeasance, malfeasance, and misfeasance. And nonfeasance, they're easy to understand, even though this language is probably something you've never used before. Nonfeasance is a failure to act. Malfeasance is performing a wrongful act that I have no right to perform. And misfeasance is improperly performing an act that I do have the right to perform. So basically, it's not doing something, I'm not supposed to do, and making a mistake. Bribery is the offering, giving, receiving, or soliciting of anything of value for the purpose of influencing action by public officials. The crime of bribery can be applied to either bribe givers or bribe takers. So bribery goes both ways, essentially. Modern statutes recognize three kinds of bribery. There's official, in which government officials are bribed. Quasi-official, in which non-government officials or non-officials who perform official functions. And occupational. This is the private sector, businesses. If I begin trying to bribe a wealthy executive, that is still another form of bribery. It's occupational. Now, escape. This usually refers to running away from the police or running away from prison. Either authorities by someone who's in custody. So if I'm in custody and I try to run away, I am committing the crime of escape. The elements are that the actor is in custody, the prisoner takes an unauthorized leave or fails to return from an authorized leave, and it has to be a physical act of departing. So I am actually running away after being in custody. Now, just to summarize these particular public order offenses, obstructing a highway or a public passage, if I am protesting something and I obstruct a highway, that is a public order offense. Flag burning is actually speech. It is freedom of speech. But if it is likely to incite someone, it is essentially fighting words, and it can be regulated. But burning the flag, even though it might be offensive to most people, is freedom of speech, unless it incites someone. And then lastly, something called abusing of corpse. It happens. In other words, and for example, suppose your mortal enemy has passed away, and you go to the funeral home to make sure they've passed away, and you begin slapping the corpse. That's abuse of a corpse. It sounds odd, but some people do engage in that sort of behavior. And then finally, environmental crimes. There's a fairly long history to environmental laws, but it hasn't been until the very modern era that the protection of the environment has become a fairly common and very intricate legal or area of criminal law. The thing is that the environment used to be exploited completely. Now it is protected. And so anyone who violates that protection of the environment has just committed an environmental crime. And there are a number of them. Generally, environmental laws are intended to do the following: protect and preserve the natural environment, which makes sense, protect the rivers, the forests, the deserts, mountains. But this is done to protect the health of the people also. For example, I grew up in a factory area outside of the city of Pittsburgh. There were steel mills and factories everywhere, and I could quite literally smell the air as I was growing up. Well, that's unhealthy. So it's there to protect the health of the people. And also to protect, preserve, and enrich the value of the nation's natural resources for future generations. It's so that we don't use them up all within our generation. That would be selfish and actually dangerous for future generations. This particular representation shows you how recent these particular laws are. They go back to the 1970s. They have been somewhat effective. Now, arguably more can be done, but these are laws which, if they are violated, someone can be held criminally responsible for this violation. And they've been somewhat effective. The air is cleaner, the environment is cleaner in many regions of the country. So, I'm Professor Gus Martin, and thank you very much again. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact me at any time. The most efficient way to contact me is through email, and you can also sit in during my virtual office hours. I will catch you next time. Be well.